Alex Rudzinski, you directed NBC's live production of Jesus Christ Superstar on Easter Sunday. You've directed other TV musicals in recent years, including Grease and Hairspray. How did this one come about?
Gosh, this one, you know, we were approached by NBC about a year back, beginning of 2017. I think Bob Greenblatt and NBC was very interested in the idea of doing something for the Easter event as opposed to doing something over the festive period and Christmas. He, through Craig Zidane and Neil Maron, they had contacts with Andrew Lloyd Webber. They pitched that this Andrew might be amenable to his work being re-aired in a live theatrical style, something which NBC obviously had a fantastic track history with. So I think Bob jumped at the chance. It's obviously a very well-known book narrative, as it were, and felt that it would be a perfect addition to the network for the Easter weekend. So it was a fantastic, you know, I was brought up in London in my teens with Andrew Lloyd Webber's work, and I think the opportunity to work on such an epically loved production was just amazing from the get-go.
And how well did you know this particular show before you took it on?
Yeah, I knew a lot of the songs from the album. I think I went and watched some of the previous stage presentations that it's played. You know, gosh, it's been like 40 plus years since it originally landed the album. It's been in multitude of venues. It's never really been staged as a live television broadcast before, but there's definitely material out there in terms of theatrical proscenium presentations and arena presentations. And so myself and the stage director, David Laveau, you know, we just did our homework a little bit on some of the prior productions. And then, you know, really lent into what we felt could really change and be fresh and bring it to a newer audience in a way that hadn't been done before. And I think we were pretty successful in that. I think its staging was fairly unique for this live TV broadcast.
Yeah, and that was a unique staging in that it was staged as a concert for a live audience there at the venue. And for the TV audience as well at home, did that require a much different approach from what you've done before?
You know, we've never, I think for all the musicals that we've done before, we've obviously Grease kind of kicked the ball rolling with having a live audience, but we didn't have the kind of numbers that we had on Superstar. So I think Grease, we might've had 300 people out there on the back lot at Warner Brothers. I think, you know, we were closer to 2000 for Superstar, so it's a very different ambience. I think what's fantastic about having an audience on a show like this is for the home viewer, you kind of, there's this visceral energy in the environment, and sometimes I feel in the past when you do these live presentations, you land an amazing number that's emotive and you love the music and everything else. And if there's no audience there, there's kind of then a sterility that reverberates at the end of that production number because it's just like, you know, footsteps walking away. And we're all used to going, you know, most of us have had the chance at some point in our lives to go and see a stage production of some sort, whether it's a musical or not. And so we're au fait with the concept of having, you know, having a big musical number land and then having applause. And so it's a common concept. And so I think having that energy in the house, not only does it lift the cast in terms of their performance, they react to it really well, but I think for the viewers at home, it just feels right in terms of buttoning energy at the end of some of those really big numbers. And look, the reason we do these is because they're live. You know, there's no real resonance for doing Grease not live or Jesus Christ Superstar not live. You know, the live tag is really important on these events, and so you're trying to lean into that liveness, and I think by having those large numbers of people enjoy it in synchronicity at the same moment, that brings something extra special across the airwaves to people in their living rooms.
The show brought together, you know, you had John Legend in the title role, and also Sarah Bareilles.
We had a cast. We did. We were very blessed. The Lord was looking down on us in terms of our casting for the Easter weekend. Honestly, man, amazing cast. You couldn't put. I mean, Brandon and Sarah and John. Alice Cooper, man, where else do you get to see Alice Cooper perform with John Legend at the same time? It's just like, it's so random, and yet it's so worked for this production. I think I feel fairly confident in saying that's probably the only time that Alice and John will be performing together on the stage. Casting is so important on these events, and I think they all understood their parts incredibly well, and the chemistry, not only casting but chemistry, it's all very well to put leads into great roles, but you've also got to create this incredible chemistry and this family unit whereby they all really understand the relationships between each other within the narrative arc of the show. And I think that was incredibly successful on Superstar.
And you never know, you might see after this John Legend and Alice Cooper inspired to do like maybe a collaboration album.
Never know. Stranger things might have happened, but not much stranger things happened. So I don't know. I can tell you this: Alice had an amazing time. He thoroughly enjoyed every second of it, and he got more and more confident every rehearsal that we did. And you saw him, marching up to the audience and saying, "Good evening, Jerusalem." And he played with it and made it his own. And went a little bit off book, and I thought that was fantastic.
Now, the show was staged at the Marcy Avenue Armory in Brooklyn. I was actually there in the audience when it was
performed. Oh, did you have a great time?
I did, and it's such a grand space that, the size and depth.
It's impressive, right? You walk in there and you're just like, wow, this is amazing. And I think that's wonderful. I think whenever you stage something of that magnitude in terms of the work, if you can go into an environment that isn't just a classic soundstage where you're limited by the four walls, to find this specific venue in New York, oh my God, it's so tough to find that kind of real estate and that footprint. We were really lucky. The community were great to us. And so I think by just having, one of the other differences that you must have noticed from Superstar with the other musicals was it was all on one soundstage in one location, or really one set, And so that's a big departure to what we've done in the past. And again, I think at each one of these events, we look to bring something new to the table and for it to stand apart from its predecessor. But I think with Marcy, the grandeur and the scale of the environment was just this very apt setting to tell the story.
And, having just that one setting as opposed to multiple, did that make it logistically easier, or were there something harder?
Yeah. From a live broadcast director's point of view, not having to get from one end of Warner Brothers to the other end of Warner Brothers in 25 seconds on golf carts with the entire production team is definitely easier.
And was there a musical number or set piece that, when you saw the show being performed that you were especially proud of, how it turned out?
I think there were a whole raft of amazing moments in the show, but I think everyone felt that the crucifixion scene at the end was particularly emotive. And I think what we in conjunction with our amazing production designer and our lighting designer, we pulled off something that was very epic and really very fresh to television in terms of John's crucifixion and the way that he kind of disappears into the mist through the walls splitting at the end. That was pretty powerful TV, and I feel it's rare that these days that I feel you can create something that's unique and not derivative of something else. I feel that was one of those beats. I really felt that we landed something that had never been done before on live television, and it was a pretty stunning emotive moment.
And with the way that that wall opens up very large set, what was it? How was it to get that to come off? What was that a challenging thing to set up?
It's a lot of rehearsals, a lot of planning. I'll tell you this: that it we never nailed it. Even in the dress rehearsal the night before, we never perfectly nailed it. There were so many intricate parts. It wasn't just the wall splitting symmetrically. That's a challenge. That's computer controlled. John flying back at exactly the right seconds, all the camera shots lining up, all the actors like kneeling down at the exact count on the music, and the music complicated at that point. There's no real lyrical rhythm to it. So it's just like drones and wails. And so musically, in terms of choreography, it's hard to be very, very precise. There was just a lot of elements that have to play, to have to line up perfectly to land that scene. And we only nailed it on the night, which was a little worried the night before, because we were all like, everyone was holding, there were so many things that could go wrong. So it was one of those deep, you know, you're kind of, everyone's hunched up in the moment in the control room thinking, yeah, is this going to play out? And it did, it landed beautifully. But I think sometimes, again, going back to the liveness of it all, it's important sometimes that you reach for the stars and you go full out and you tread a little bit dangerously, because I think the viewers appreciate that. And so, you know, sometimes you question yourself in pre-production. It's like, are we going to, you know, is this too risky? If John gets stuck up there, where do we go? You know, you're trying to do your disaster planning, your permutations planning, but it's a live event. It's the culmination of almost 3 hours of television. You really don't want to screw that up. And so you're trying to do risk assessment as you go through it. Should we simplify? You know, should John not fly back? Should he just raise up and then we switch the light off? But I think ultimately you also feel you balance that, knowing that if you really create something that is insanely dynamic and helps embellish the story well, then it's a great experience for the viewers, and that's always what we're trying to look for.
As you've done, you know, more and more of these TV musicals, you know, they're with such a variety of staging on, you know, very many of them. Have you learned a lot about what like really works and what doesn't in approaching one of these shows, or does it always change?
It always changes. The challenges are always different. I think that's great. I think we don't want to ever bring one of these events to the table where it feels derivative of something else. I think we're always trying to raise the bar and give the viewers a new experience. I hope they always feel that there's something fresh, so that it's worthy of them coming, you know, as a family unit, gathering around their television sets for an evening. We're asking a lot of them. We're asking like 2 to 3 hours of entertainment. We're asking for them to invest their time in us. I think it's only right that we are, you know, worthy to the narrative book and to them by bringing something fresh. So they're all a little different. You know, it's always, they're always a logistical planning nightmare. You never have enough rehearsal time. But I can also tell you that they are the most fun, enjoyable projects to work on, without doubt. That all of us as a production team are honored to be able to bring to everyone's TV screens. So they are amazing to do.
And they've been pretty well received, especially in the last few years. You won a couple of Emmys for Grease for Best Special Class Program and yeah. Best Directing, thank along you. With Thomas Kail. Did you anticipate that show would be received as well as it was?
No, I think we knew that the Grease is in the zeitgeist for America. I think so many people, even today, so many kids go through high school and get the opportunity to perform that musical. So it's very pan-generational. The music is really beloved. We knew that was a strong entity. It's also kind of a frothy musical. It's not deep or heartfelt or, you know, incredibly sanctimonious in any way. It's light, very lighthearted in terms of its message. But it's fun. It's endearing to watch. So, and I felt what we brought to Grease was this, just this incredible kinetic energy to it, this pace, and this breaking down of this, but I felt the musicals up to that point had been very proscenium. And I think Tommy and me felt that what we should do differently was really try and open up, break the fourth wall, as it were, and say, hey, we're live, and yes, we're on a backlot, and yes, there's 8 sound stages and 16 sets, and we have to get to the carnival at the end, and why hide the mechanics of all that? Why not embrace it? And why not show people what you're actually doing live? Because I think the audience, you know, they're clever, the audience, they're smart. So if you're making this big thing about saying it's a live event and you're underlining that, show that, lean into it, and trust the audience that they'll enjoy that beat as well. The audience love to play along. They're like looking for, we nearly rolled a golf cart over on the way to the carnival at the end. It's like, that wasn't planned. But they love that. Those are the social media moments that fly into the Twitter sphere. And I think if you're going to embellish these live events, you kind of want people to play along. You want there to be this frisson of what could happen next. So I think Greece started that a little bit.
And this season, you also directed the live TV production of A Christmas Story. How was that different from?
That was insane. That was so hard. I mean, I think December 17th in Los Angeles, which is pretty sunny in LA in December, luckily. And yet we had to be in Cleveland, I think it was, in the snow. We were literally chopping up chunks of ice into snow bits and blasting the entire, literally half a kilometer of Warner Brothers with snow overnight for 3 days to try and get snow everywhere. I mean, just crazy challenges. We chose to shoot actually in the backlot. We chose to shoot in backlot buildings as opposed to going to sound stages. That made our lives really hard because you don't have the space that you have on a sound stage to scale up and to get cameras in. We were going into real scale living rooms, like the Parker House was a real scale living room. You've literally got 1 foot between the table in front of the lounge sofa and the fireplace. And I've got 4 cameras in there in 1 foot, and everyone's shoulder to shoulder, like, what are we doing? I'm trying not to show them. I wish you could show like a wide shot of the crick. Literally, you had like 15 people in the line, just out of the edge of frame. So that was crazy for different reasons, but it was great fun.
And next, coming up, NBC's got a live production in the works for A Few Good Men, which is a play as opposed to a musical.
Exciting. I'm not sure how much I can tell you about that, but it's Aaron, and what can you say other than Aaron is a god and a genius? And I am thrilled to be working on a project like that. To bring really the dramatic form into as a live event. I think that's another, I've been talking about raising the bar. That's another perfect analogy for raising the bar, because I think it brings, now we have an opportunity, which is tough, to bring live drama. It's been done a little bit with, there've been singular episodes of ER in the past that have been live. But I think this is a whole new ballpark kind of thing. So I think we have a challenge there. It's a well-known work. A lot of people obviously watched the movie with Tom Cruise. Now we have a challenge to put our own spin on that live event and really, it's a heavyweight piece of work. So I think the screenplay and the design of dramatization for that is going to be a challenge to make the audience appreciate it's live and not just, I think that's where we have our work cut out. Not to be distracting, but to augment the story in a way that's totally in harmony with it.
Yeah, it's not a musical, but I for one just am fascinated. Like if Aaron Sorkin ever wanted to make it a musical, I would love to hear a song with Aaron Sorkin lyrics.
Yeah, that'd be a good spin. That's kind of a mashup idea, but I like it.
congratulations on Jesus Christ Superstar, right. Christmas Story, and best luck on A Few Good Men coming up. Thank you so much for talking to me today.
All right, you have a great day. Thanks for your time.